believe God. I don't care what it looked like. I don't care what you're experiencing, people of God. I don't care what you're going through. But right now, right where you are, believe God, because God is working it out on your behalf. He is a healer. He is a deliverer. He is a way maker. Hallelujah. And I don't care what you are faced with. I don't care what you are going through with. I tell you one thing, if you will seek his face, call on the name of the Lord, he will deliver. And we give God praise on this morning. Amen, amen, amen. I don't know about you, but I must agree that I'm happy right down in my sanctified soul. Amen. We're certainly praying for each and every one of you, praying for bereaved families everywhere. We're praying for the healing of our country, the healing of our land. Hallelujah. And those who think that God has forsaken us, I want you to know this morning, God is yet in control. Regardless of what it looked like, regardless of what it smelled like, God is in control. We're going to ask the praise and worship time event. Sister Valencia Neely and the Voices of Deliverance are going to lead us in our praise and worship, followed by our morning scripture, Evangelist Claritha Nelson.
Thank you. from Joel chapter 2, beginning at verse 23 through 27. Amen. And it reads thus: Be glad then, ye children of Zion, and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he hath given you the former rain moderately, and he will cause to come down for you the rain, the former rain and the latter rain in the first month. And the floors shall be full of wheat, and the fats shall overflow with wine and oil. And I will restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten, the canker worm and the caterpillar and the pommel worm, my great army which I sent among you. And ye shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and none else, and my people shall never be ashamed. And the reading of God's word on this morning is blessed.
Amen. Praise God. Thank God for the word of the Lord. Amen. That's one of my favorite scriptures. I will restore to you what the cankerworm has destroyed. Why? Because he said, I am the Lord your God. Hallelujah. Restoration for the people of God. Praise God. Thank God for the word of the Lord on this morning. This time, the ministry of dance, we've gone back in our archives, and our babies, our little diamonds, as we call them, they're going to come forth in the ministry of dance, dancing to He Wants It All. The Lord wants all of us, not part of us, not part-time, but He wants all of us, the diamonds in the ministry of dance.
Searching for a heart that will love him, longing for a child that will give him their all, give it all, he wants it all. And there's a God that wants over the earth. He's searching for a heart that is desperate, and longing for a child that will give him their all, give it all, he wants it all. He says, love me with your whole heart. He wants it all today. Serve me with your life now. He wants it all today. Bow down, let go of your idols. He wants it all today. He wants it all today. He wants it all today. He wants it all. And there's a God that walks over the earth. He's searching for a heart that is desperate, longing for a child that will give him their all. Give it all. He wants it all. He says, love me with your heart. Bow down, let go of your mind,
Amen. He wants it all today, not yet tomorrow, but he wants it all today. The Lord wants all of you right now. Praise God. We certainly thank God for our babies, our diamonds, amen, dancing on this morning for us. We're getting ready now to hear the word of the Lord coming through our assistant pastor, Elder Chris Rouse. Amen. We certainly thank God for this young man, a young man that loves the Lord, loves his wife, loves his family. And you know what? He loves the people of God. We thank God for him, a man who lives holy inside the church and at home. And we give him praise for this young man. God is doing great things in his life. We thank God for the many doors that are opening up to him. And he's going to come and share the word of the Lord on this morning. But before he shall come, we're going to have another selection from the Voices of Deliverance, after which our speaker, Elder Christopher Brian Rouse Sr., will come and share the word of the Lord.
Hallelujah. We want to thank the Lord for another day. We want to thank him for another chance to give him praise. We exalt the Lord on today and we lift his name higher. Thank you, Jesus. Let's just worship him all together. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh, my soul rejoice. Take joy, my King, in what you hear, and let it be a sweet, sweet, sweet sound in your ear. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice to worship you, oh my soul, rejoice, take joy, my King, in what you hear, and let it be a sweet, sweet sound in your ear. Oh, we exalt thee, we exalt thee, we exalt thee, oh
Oh, Lord, we exalt.
Lord.
Hallelujah. Oh, bless his holy name. How many of you love the Lord on this morning? Hallelujah. How many of you love the Lord on this morning? Thank you, Jesus. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this Sunday morning. Thank you for your love and your kindness, your meekness, your temperance, and your long-suffering. Father God, we thank you for being just who you are. We ask you now that all these airways that you will step on in, Father God, that you will let your anointing fall all through these airways on this morning, Father God. To all of those that are listening through Facebook and listening online on this morning, let your anointing fall right where they are. Let your anointing fall that destroys the yoke. Let your anointing fall that makes preaching easy. Father God, I ask now that you would decrease me and increase all of you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. Hallelujah. I certainly thank God for Jesus on this morning. I thank God for the voice of deliverance and Sister Valencia leading us in that song, I Love You, Lord. Hallelujah. That's my testimony on this morning, is that I love the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. I certainly thank God for that. I want to give an honor to God, who's ahead of my life. Give an honor to our pastor, Pastor Shirley Rouse, on this morning. Certainly thank God for you, for all the ministerial staff there at Agape. Thank God for each and one of you, and every member, every family member, every friend, every visitor of the Agape Church. We thank God for you on this morning. So all of you that may be listening to this online, we certainly thank God for you. I'm not going to be before you long, but I certainly believe that there is a word from the Lord on this morning. On this morning, I'll be coming from the book of 1 Samuel, the 17th chapter, verses 45 through 51. That's 1 Samuel chapter 17. Verses 45 through 51. We certainly thank God for our media specialist, Dr. Melanie, on this morning. The word of the Lord says, then said David to the Philistine, thou comest to me with a sword and with a spear and with a shield, but I come to thee in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom thou hast defied. This day will the Lord deliver thee into my hand, and I will smite thee and take thine hair from thee, and I will give thee the carcass of the host of the Philistine this day unto the fowls of the air and to the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel. And all this assembly shall know the Lord saveth not with sword or spear, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. And it came to pass, when the Philistine arose and came and drew nigh to meet David, that David hastened and ran toward the army to meet the Philistine. And David put his hand in his bag, and he took thence a stone and sling it, and smote the Philistine in his forehead, that the stone sunk into his forehead, and he fell upon his face to the earth. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a slingshot with a stone, and smote the Philistine, and slew him. But there was no sword in the hand of David. Therefore David ran and stood upon the Philistine and took his sword and drew it out of the sheath thereof and slew him and cut off his head therewith. And when the Philistines saw the champion was dead, they fled. And the reading of God's word is blessed on this morning. Hallelujah. For a few short minutes, I just want to speak to you off on the topic of secrets of a giant killer. Secrets of a giant killer. Oftentimes we face challenges in our lives that seems like it is going to be impossible to overcome. These challenges seems like it's going to be impossible to overcome, and they're standing right there in front of us, taunting us like a giant. But on today, we are going to awaken the giant killer that is on the inside of each one of us. You may ask the question, Brother Rouse, am I truly a giant killer? And the answer is simply, yes, you are. No matter what it may look like or how you feel, you are a giant killer. God will never allow you to be confronted by a challenge that you cannot conquer. The aim of this message on today is to awaken the giant killer that is on the inside of each and every one of us. Before David ever went up against the Philistine, he had everything that he already needed on the inside of him to defeat his giant. David already possessed a heart of a champion. He already had a mind of a conqueror, and he was already an overcomer. Sometimes when you are faced with a giant, you're going to have to encourage yourself. You're going to have to remind yourself that you are a champion, that you are an overcomer, and that you are a conqueror. And our scriptural text, it comes from a very popular story in the Old Testament of David and Goliath. I'm pretty sure that we have all heard this story numerous of times in our life. David was a young man when he was appointed to be the king of Israel at the age of 15. But it did not happen until he turned 30 years old. When you look at the story of David, it should be a reminder that a delay is not a denial. Because I'm reminded in the Bible, in the book of Habakkuk, chapter 2, verse 3, where it says, "For the vision is yet for an appointed time, but at the end it shall speak and not lie. Though it tarry, wait for it, because surely it will come, it will not tarry." Can you imagine if you were David and you are anointed to be king at the age of 15, but you don't end up sitting on the throne until age 30, 15 years later? I just want to encourage somebody here today and let them know that it feels like the promises of God is taking too long to come to pass. That may feel like the promises are not being fulfilled in your life. That you may find yourself asking, where is God? I just want you to know that a delay is not a denial. You may have been praying for a long time. You may be ready to give up. But on today, I want you to know that your blessing is delayed. It is not denied. Just don't get weary in well doing. Because the Bible says you shall reap if you faint not. Yeah. The Bible also proclaims that God is not slack concerning his promise. If God promised it to you, he's going to bring it to pass. If he said it, then he will do it. Because God is not slack concerning his promise. So in our text, David was a giant killer. And he had five secrets that he used to slay Goliath. Number one, David was confident and courageous. Sometimes you have to be confident in God and courageous enough to step out on faith. David was confident and he was courageous. When Goliath came out, all of the children of Israel, they went into hiding. Because of the Goliath size and his stature, everybody around them was intimidated by Goliath, including the king of Israel and Saul. Everyone was afraid. David's oldest brothers were all afraid to face the giant. His older brothers had already enlisted in the army. They have already been through basic training. They had specialized in combat. But when Goliath came out, they were afraid to face their giant. David was just at this time, he was just a 15-year-old shepherd boy. He was just an ordinary guy. There was nothing really special about David. But you have to notice that God can use ordinary people to do extraordinary assignments. We can all take a lesson from David and learn not to put limits on ourselves. David could have realized and said, "I am just a shepherd boy. I am 15 years old. I'm not even an adult yet. I haven't reached 18. I have no business joining the army of Israel. I have no business going to face Goliath." We have to learn to quit putting limits on ourselves. Sometimes the reason why God's promises seems like it takes forever to come to pass is because we have put limits on ourselves. We hear the promises of God, we hear the word of God, but then we only think that that applies to other people. People of God, we have to realize that the word of God applies to us, and we need to learn to take the limits off of ourselves. So David, he was just a shepherd boy taking care of his father's sheep. And his father gives him an insignificant assignment. His dad tells him to go down to your brothers and take them some lunch. He was given an insignificant assignment. His dad basically told him, "Why don't you be your brother's Uber Eats driver and drop them off some food. A very insignificant assignment, but you have to realize that every assignment in your life, regardless of how small, has purpose. You can't look over the insignificant assignment because it yet has purpose. It yet has a learning experience attached to it. Because if David would have stayed home instead of taking his brother's lunch, he would have never faced his giant. Some of us struggle to face our giants because we struggle with the insignificant things that we find to be insignificant in our lives. There is a lesson in everything. There is a lesson in everything. So David was taking his brother's lunch. When Goliath came out taunting the children of Israel, asking, is this somebody that is willing to fight me? For 40 days and 40 nights, twice a day, once in the morning and once in the evening, Goliath came out and said, is there anybody willing to stand up against me? At this time, Goliath has a complete stronghold over the children of Israel. The Bible says that David began to ask, what would be done to the man that would bring this Philistine down? Before David came, everyone was talking about the problem. But when David showed up, he was a man of courage, and he began to introduce the name of his God. One of his brothers stepped in and said, you are just a boy. Who did you leave our father's sheep to? In this journey of life, you are going to run into discouraging people. People that are going to try to discourage you to go after your goals and your dreams because they are afraid of their own goals and dreams. David's brothers came out to him. They was criticizing him. They was discouraging him because they were the ones that were afraid. We cannot allow for other people's fears and failures and their afraidness to stop us. We don't take that leap of faith because somebody we talked to was afraid to take that leap. We say, well, they're stuck where they are. The same thing may happen to me. But we have to be willing to step out on our own faith. So in life, you are going to meet discouraging people. People that will come to simply to try to drain you. People that's going to come and try to drain your hope. They try to steal your dreams, steal your joy, take your happiness, and take your ambitions from you. This is why we must learn, people of God, how to have selective hearing. Anybody with children know exactly what I mean when I say having selective hearing. Our kids hear us, but they only decide to hear what they want to hear. They only try to pick out the pieces that they want to hear. You can call their name all day long, but until they feel like saying something, or until you get some aggressiveness behind it, they will act like they did not hear and things. So people of God, we have to learn how to have selective hearing and keep those discouraging people out of our ears. You cannot allow for these draining words that people try to spew out to stop you or to affect you. When David's brother said all of that to him, he let it roll off of his back. If my daddy was here, he'll put it this way, you gotta let it roll off your back like the water rolling down a duck's back. Hallelujah. So number two, people of God, we have to be a man or woman of faith. Ask yourself, where is my faith? Is your faith bigger than your fear? Your faith should be bigger than your giant. Everyone feared Goliath. When everyone saw Goliath, they thought that this guy was too big for us to face. But when David saw Goliath, he thought that this guy was too big to miss. Everyone else thought that Goliath was too big to face, but David thought that the giant Goliath was too big to miss. This is what you call having a mindset change. Because oftentimes we look at a glass of water either being half full or half empty, optimistic or pessimistic. But regardless of how you view the water, when you have a mindset change, you realize that the glass can always be refilled. Hallelujah. You realize that it can always be refilled. David thought he was too big to miss. The question becomes, what is your perspective? Is your giant too big to miss, or is it too big to face? A wise man once said that perception is reality. How you perceive a thing becomes your reality. If you perceive yourself being broke, then you're going to be broke. If you perceive yourself being defeated by your giant, you're going to be defeated. If you perceive yourself being less than, then you're going to be less than. Perception becomes reality. So what is it? Is the glass half full or is it half empty? Can you refill your glass? Hallelujah. Now watch this, people of God. Not only can the glass be refilled, but the glass can also be replaced. Mm-hmm. You drunk all of the water out of that water bottle. You have the option to go to the sink to refill it, or you have an option to replace the water bottle. What option will you choose? Just say to your neighbor, I am not out of options. I am not out of options. Hallelujah. You have to choose what your perception and what your reality will be. So David thought that Goliath was too big for him to miss. David's faith was bigger than his fears. I pray on today that your faith will become bigger than your fears. Because in the book of Romans, chapter 10, verse 17, it says, so then faith coming by hearing and hearing by the word of God. My prayer is on this morning, by you hearing the word of God, that your faith would become bigger than any fear or obstacle, any giant that you may have in your life. I pray that your faith would be strengthened, that you would be given the strength to overcome, the strength to defeat your giants, the strength to do extraordinary things, the strength to step out on faith, the strength to be the first one in your family, the strength to face your giant. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. What is your perception going to be? And David also knew how to handle criticism. The third secret to defeating a giant is to know how to handle criticism. When his brothers tried to speak negatively towards him and criticize him, he did not entertain them. He had selective hearing. Two things in life we must learn how to handle. Number one, we have to learn how to handle the praises from people, as well as learn how to handle the criticisms from people. Because when you allow, you have to be careful not to allow criticism to get in your heart, and you cannot always take it personal. And then secondly, you have to watch praises of people that it does not get to your ego. You have to be careful to not allow the praises of people to get to your ego, to have you thinking more highly of yourself than you ought to. Because after all, when Jesus came rolling into Jerusalem, people came in singing, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed be the rock. And those same people began to sing, crucify him by the end of the week. So we have to watch the praises of people and not allow it to get to our ego. In this journey called life, there's always going to be somebody criticizing you. And we have to also realize that not all criticism is bad. And we cannot take it personal. Some people truly just want to help you in life. It's not that they're trying to talk about you or demean you. They are trying to provide you with constructive criticism. And when that constructive criticism comes, we cannot allow for it to hurt our feelings, stick our tail between our legs, and go home. Has anybody ever received a hard truth that was hard to accept, but the person was right? It was exactly what you needed to hear, but it was hard for you to accept it? If you have never experienced that in life, you need to find a new circle of friends. You need to find some new church members. You need to find a new pastor. You need to find some new people to put around you if you never gotten the hard truth that was hard to accept. Because the truth is, your friends shouldn't always just be yes men. Your pastor isn't always going to tell you what you want to hear. If you get upset about it and you decide to stay home and leave with God pay, that's exactly what you needed to hear. Your pastor did nothing wrong but tell you exactly what you needed to hear. Thank you, Jesus. There has been times in my life when I have gotten constructive criticism, which I really didn't want to hear. But when I sat back and think about it, it's like, you know what? They have a point there. They might just be right. Let me re-examine that situation and make sure that I'm just not reacting emotionally to constructive criticism. Because people of God, our emotions oftentimes get us in trouble. We have to learn not to always react with a ton of emotions and emotionally, but we have to learn how to think critically about that situation and say, well, what is my part in this? And I have a whiteboard, even on my mirror in my bedroom, my whiteboard in my office, I put on there, challenge every perspective. Because I want to ensure that I am looking at something from every angle. You may ask, why did you put it on the mirror in your bedroom? Why do you have it written in your office? Because I want it as a daily reminder that I need to challenge every perspective. It's so easy to get wrapped up in what you think is right and what you think is wrong. So we have to learn how to challenge every perspective. Because if you were to examine the life of Jesus, he was criticized at every turn, but he was yet blameless. But the good news is that your destiny is not tied to your critics. Because some people try to provide constructive criticism, and some people just like to be mean, nasty, and ugly. Hello, somebody. We all know some people like that that's just mean, nasty, and ugly. Jesus was criticized by the systems of his day. He was criticized for healing a man on the Sabbath. He was criticized for going out to eat with tax collectors. But in spite of it all, Jesus yet ran his own race and fulfilled his own destiny. He did not allow the criticism to stop him. That is the same thing with David. David's brothers came and was criticizing him, but he did not allow for it to stop him. Paul was criticized for preaching a message of grace. Moses was criticized for whom he chose to marry, but they never allowed the critics to stop him. Because when God speaks, everyone else is just making noise. We have to realize that in our life, God has the final say. God has the final word in our life. So not only do we have to learn how to handle criticism, learn how to handle praises, but we need to remember past victories. We really need to remember what God has already done in our life. When David said that he was going to fight Goliath and he was brought before King Saul, he said, before you count me out, allow me to tell my story. He said, allow me to tell you about the past victories that I had. David said, can I just testify for a second? David had a testimony service all by himself. He must have recalled what the Bible says in the book of Revelation, that they overcame him by the blood of the Lamb and the words of their testimony. For some of us, this is the reason why we cannot face our current giants in our lives. Because we have forgotten the past victories God has gave us. Because if God did it before, he would do it again. David said to King Saul, while I was taking care of my father's sheep in the wilderness, a lion and a bear came. I conquered the lion and I conquered the bear. And the God that rescued me while I was in the wilderness is going to be the same God that will provide, that will give me victory over Goliath. David remembered past victories. Don't forget what God has already done for you. If God made a way for you before, he would do it again. If he helped you before, he can do it again. If he protected you before, he can do it again. Hallelujah. Sometimes you have to take a jog down memory lane and remember past victories. That's why the saints of old used to say, as I look back over my life and I think things over, I can truly say that I've been blessed and I have a testimony. Does anybody have a testimony on this morning? Has God brought anybody out of something on this morning? Has God made a way for somebody on this morning? As you face your giants in your lives in 2021, you have to remember all of the past victories that God has already given you. Because if he did it before, he would do it again. Hallelujah, he would do it again. But the most important thing that David realized, he realized that the battle was not his, but it was the Lord's. When he was facing Goliath, he said, you have come to me with spear and with javelin, but I have come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts. David went and he collected 5 smooth stones. I was wondering, why did you only collect 5 smooth stones? But he only used 1. And the thought came to me, well, you spelled the name Jesus with 5 letters, J-E-S-U-S. David was saying that he has come to his giant in the name of the Lord. In whose name are you confronting your giants in? That's why the Bible says that it is the name above every name, and every knee shall bow. Every situation, every giant will bow to the name of Jesus. Because there is power in the name of the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. There is power in the name of the Lord. So David, he went and collected his 5 stones, but he only used 1. How do you know that Jesus is everything that you need? He's a way maker. He's a deliverer. He's a comforter, a strong tower, a healer. He's the lily of the valley, the bright and morning star. He's the rose that shines. He is my everything. But sometimes when I am facing my giants, all I need Jesus to be is 1 stone. I have all 5 stones in my pocket. But when I'm going through, sometimes when I'm all alone, I just need him to be my comforter. When I'm hurting, I just need him to be my healer. When I think too highly of myself, I need him to be my humbler. When I'm hungry and thirsty, I need him to be my bread of life. When I'm being talked about, mistreated, abused, broken down, tossed around, getting beat up from the feet up, getting towed up from the floor, all I need him to be is King Jesus. Hallelujah. How many of you need King Jesus on this morning? Because there is power in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Jesus will give you the strength and power to overcome every giant in your life. He will give you victory over the giant of sickness, over the giant of affliction, over the giant of lack, over the giant of less than, the giant of disobedience, the giant of discouragement, the giant of depression, and the giant of failure. Any battle that you are facing in life, God will fight for you. Because the battle is not yours, but it is the Lord's. But the key is we cannot be scared to face our giants. The battle may not be ours, it is the Lord's, but David yet had to show up to the battle to get the victory. Hallelujah. We cannot be afraid to show up to the battle. Oftentimes, people are afraid to face their issues and their giants. The problem with doing this is that your giant will never go away, but rather our giant grows bigger and bigger. The bigger our giant grows and our confidence gets smaller and smaller. Since God has not given us the spirit of fear, but of love, power, and a sound mind, I am not afraid to face my giant, because I am coming after my giant in the name of Jesus. The Bible says, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. His rod and his staff comfort me. He prepares a table before me in the presence of my enemies. He anoints my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. The secrets of a giant killer. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for this word that you sent to our house. Thank you, for Father God, for encouraging us to face our giants. Thank you for letting us know that we are a giant killer. We thank you now for the victory in advance. We thank you for the victory over our giants, Father God. We thank you now because the battle is not ours, but it is yours. And we are turning it over to you now. We're turning our giants over to you now. Every obstacle, every situation, everything that we face, Father God, we give it to you, Father God. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen. And we are in the hands of Pastor Rouse.
Praise God. Amen. God bless you, man of God. Hallelujah. What a powerful, powerful and anointed word on this morning. Secrets of a giant killer. He gave us the secrets to use to be a giant killer. My God. Hallelujah. What a powerful word on this morning. We certainly thank God for Elder Chris, and what a powerful word that he shared with us on this morning. We are giant killers, because the scripture after all said, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. The secret of a giant killer. We thank God for your joining us on today. Hallelujah. My soul is rejoicing. My soul is rejoicing. My soul is rejoicing. Hallelujah. And as we've said previously, it doesn't matter what it looked like. Hallelujah. You got to be like David and let the giant killer rise up in you. I don't care where you are in life right now. Hallelujah. In the name of Jesus, you can slay your giant. That's something personal. You got to say to yourself, I can slay my giant. We all have different giants that we are faced with. But the secret is, hallelujah, use the name of Jesus. And remember those past things that God has done for you in the past. We thank God for the word of God that has been shared. And Father, we thank you for every person that has heard the word on today. We thank you for the man of God. We ask that you would strengthen him in Jesus' name. God, we thank you now. We thank you, God. Oh, God, we pray now for those who not have accepted you as Lord and Savior, that they will ask you to come into their lives and to their hearts in the name of Jesus. Father, we pray now for healing, healing for the people, healing for our land, healing for our families in the name of Jesus. Oh, God, we pray for the bereaved families everywhere. Continue to pray for the Roe Holiday family, praying for the Wilson family. And Father, we're praying this morning for the Dunlap family. We thank you now, God, for what you have done in our lives. And we give you glory. We give you the praise. And we give you the honor. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. God bless you. We thank you for joining us on today. We pray that you will join us on Wednesday night at 7 p.m. for our prayer and Bible study. Prayer and Bible study on this coming Wednesday night. Amen. By the way of giving, Agape, we ask that you give your tithes and your offering. Amen. You can give through Cash App. Cash App name is $Agape Kogic, AGAPECOGIC 20. That is, you can give through Cash App, and you can give through Givelify, Agape Deliverance, Church of God in Christ. We ask that you be a financial blessing to the church. This is your gift tithing period. Amen. To give of your tithes, to give an offering. a worthy offering to the Lord. All of our visitors that have joined us and that are watching online, you may also give, amen, to sow a seed into the ministry so that we can continue doing the will of the Lord. You can also give through Cash App, Agape Kojic 20, or you can give through the Givelify app. Just search on Agape Deliverance, Church of God in Christ. Do not let the devil steal this from you. Stop what you're doing right now and give your tithes, give your offerings, because you have to give your way out of financial lack. But say, Pastor, how does that work? The Bible said, give and it shall be given unto you. Good measure. That's how I'm going to do it. I'm not going to do it through Roth account, 401k, annuities and CDs and all that. I'm giving my way out of debt when I give of my tithes and I give of my offerings according to the word of the Lord. I want you to know that I love each and every one of you. I am praying for you. I am praying for you. And if you want prayer, you can contact the church. Those who are looking by Facebook can contact us via Facebook, or you may call 804-229-3457 and we will pray with you. Not only that, we will put your name on our prayer list. We pray every Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday morning from 6 a.m. to 6:15 a.m. And if you have time, join us on our prayer line at 6 o'clock in the morning, 6 a.m. to 6:15 p.m. I'm going to ask our prayer ministry to post that on our Facebook account, the prayer line number, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday, because there is urgency. We are in an urgent crisis. We are in an urgent situation, and we must pray, because prayer is the key. Prayer is the key. Amen. God bless you. I love you. Turning you now into the hands of Dr. Rouse. Be blessed, saints. I look forward to seeing you on Wednesday.
The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Whom shall I be afraid? The Lord is my light and salvation. Whom shall I fear? Yeah. Whom shall I be afraid?